We would like to welcome you to the first in a series of Halyard webcasts. These webcasts are being developed exclusively for the use of our Halyard community. Our goal with these videos is to inform our Halyard family members exactly how we have developed our supports and our approach here at Halyard. It is our hope that each of these webcasts will illustrate, enlighten, and strengthen our mission, our understanding, and our community. Let's start with our name, Halyard. A halyard is a part of a sailboat's rigging. It's used to hoist and hold the ship's sail. It is our belief that life is not lived, it is navigated, and much like a sailboat, at times we defy, and at times we direct the elements around us. Halyard agents are not the boat. We are not the sail. We are not the wind. The Halyard agents are a flexible line of support that can either hoist and hold its ship's sail or batten down the hatches. We chose the name Halyard because we did not want the name of our program or our community to make any direct reference to independence or support. Our clients went through school with labels that invited the support of professionals while inviting the judgment of their peers. At Halyard, the only label that matters is adult. Our philosophy here at Halyard is simple: to facilitate independence. Each of our adults comes to us with their own set of skills and struggles, and we must understand their individual needs and nature in order to best advise them to find the healthy balance between their potential and their sustainability. Our mission to facilitate independence is simple, but it's not easy. We are so often raised to see adulthood as a destination. So many of our interests and curiosities are postponed by the adults in our world to adulthood. You can see that, you can do that, you can have that, you might understand that when you are an adult. It's as if we're going to wake on our 18th or 21st birthday with a clarity and an understanding that answered all the questions of our youth. But adulthood is not a destination. As we all know, adulthood is its own journey. Let's start by looking at the path to adulthood.
So let's start by taking a wide-angle look at the path to adulthood. And we're going to look at this first as it would be my path to adulthood or your path to adulthood. We were all born and brought home from the hospital to our nuclear family, our parents and our siblings. And here they fed us and bathed us and napped us, but it wasn't long before our families came rushing in, our extended families, and grandparents and aunts and uncles came rushing to hold the baby and take care of the baby and connect to that baby being us. And we learned pretty quickly that grandma was a little more comfortable giving our cookies than mom was, and we learned to work with those dynamics. And then we took the hand of a loved one and we went out into the community, and we were introduced to the world around us. And we were probably off to religious services or off to the local market or the library or even the county fair. And we learned pretty quickly that there is a significant difference in the objectives of these locations and the behavioral expectations for each location. Before long, a big yellow school bus came along and we went off to school and things really picked up speed. We were introduced to new places and new faces and a whole lot of new rules and new experiences. We learned to compete and cooperate, to succeed and fail. We would find our passions, our strengths, and our weaknesses, and we would ride these and hide these through the rodeo of social acceptance. Before long, we would get mobile, and for most of us, that meant a driver's license. And from there, it was only a chip shot to true independence. And we would then from there be on our way. And somehow we made it from our parents' home to to our own home, and we all thrived and survived this mainstream path. Now, let's take a more accurate look at what our clients, our Halyard clients, might have gone through and the path they might have taken from mom's home to their own home. And this is probably a better depiction of that. Now, let's face it, the mainstream can be a confusing and stressful experience for all of us, any of us. We all had our struggles. But for a student with complex learning disabilities, the academic and social demands of the mainstream is extremely difficult and sent them to an alternate path. The reason they left the mainstream is because the pace of the expectations in the communication became overwhelming. And it's not just the amount of communication and expectations, it's not just the speed of the communication and the expectations, but it is the cumulative nature of those expectations and the communication, the skills and the practices socially and academically. Nearly everything we learned at the back of the classroom or at the back of the school bus was a building block for a future skill or a future relationship. So at some point in our clients growing up, their families sought an alternate path for their son or daughter. Now, this alternate path can be as significant as a 24/7 residential placement, or as simple as an alternate course of study within the public system. And the pace, once you get to this alternate path, the pace of the communication and the expectations for our clients, it slows way down. And the support greatly increases academically and socially. And the support and the instruction, it revolves around the student's needs and the student's skills. And at their own pace, our clients enjoy experiences and they learn valuable lessons as they grow and mature. And they gain the skills and the confidence on their way to adulthood. Our clients begin to mature and grow in this supportive environment with the right balance of communication and expectations, and allows them to make their way to adulthood. Now, on the other side of things, their cohorts are traveling this mainstream path to adulthood, and these folks are going to become their coworkers, their neighbors, their trainers at the gym, their bosses. And it's important to say that these folks are learning and having experiences that are very valuable, and they assume everyone's having them. They're learning the pace of a relationship. They're learning how to juggle a part-time job and a social life. They're learning the difference between a friend and a frenemy. But eventually, through an alternate path or through the mainstream, we all arrive here at adulthood. And here at Halyard, we guide our clients back into the mainstream. Now, this world is not as cold and cruel as some would have you believe. But it does not stop, and it does not wait. The pace of communication and expectations, of information, of responsibilities and obligation, it all returns to the speed of the mainstream. And the expectations go way up, and the communication goes way down. If we look at this, the same things that pushed our clients out to an alternate path, the pace of expectations and communication, now they're returning to that, and they're expected to keep up. This is where our Halyard agents make their living. So, this brings us to the Halyard approach. Let's talk about how Halyard does what it does. So, how do we facilitate independence for our adult clients? Well, as they return to the mainstream, we do our very best to solve for the discrepancy between their skills and the expectations of the real world. We try to maintain adult expectations for our clients with constant communication so that they can understand the expectations and meet them. Now, in order to do this, really, we must first talk about preservation of dignity, because my adult clients, they know that their needs aren't exactly age-appropriate. And this can make things rather difficult and delicate for their Halyard agents at times, and makes respect the absolute cornerstone of our relationship with our clients and our entire community. And we try to understand and relate to them, their wants, their needs, their actions and behaviors. Now, I may not always agree with what my clients do or what they say, but if we slow down, often we can understand why they did what they did or why they said what they said. And if we can understand why they did it, we have a better chance of helping their roommate understand that as well. And then we try to explain their obligations and options as an adult. We talk a lot here about natural consequences, and we try to illustrate and explain these consequences so that they can understand them. And then we give our adult clients the room and the respect to learn these lessons. Because as we Halyard agents have come to understand, the lessons of adulthood cannot be taught, but rather they must be learned. So, in the simplest of terms, this is what Halyard does. We mediate between our client's skills and understanding and the communication and the expectations of the real world. So let's start by looking at our Halyard clients. Our Halyard clients, for a variety of reasons, struggle to process, express, and receive information with speed, accuracy, and context. Physically, many of our clients struggle with the skills, abilities, and even senses to effectively manage the tasks and functions of their independent. Just last week with this projector, I asked one of my clients, who's been with me for a number of years, to plug it in because the outlet was on her side of the table. And I handed her the cord and she sort of said half out loud, half to herself, "Huh, a three-prong." And then I watched her for about 25 seconds study the three-prong in her hand and the outlet on the wall to make that work. And I thought, how complicated are our clients' daily lives? Well, on the subject of complicated, the next item we're going to talk about is social. For our clients, they need a great deal of support to create and maintain all manner of relationships. As we mentioned earlier, our clients are returning to that mainstream pace of communication and expectations. And in addition to this clash of information, communication, and expectations between our clients and the real world, there are two social factors that we Halyard agents have come to understand and consider. We call them praise deprivation and decision deprivation. And these are a result of this alternative path, a lifetime of supportive family and supportive professionals. And as our clients come to us and return to the mainstream, they're accustomed to a tremendous amount of praise. And our agents, they do their very best, but it's not uncommon for one of our clients who's returning to the mainstream to wonder where all that praise went. And as they adjust back, we have to help them adjust to the praise of independent adulthood. That same current of support of family and professionals who rallied around our clients from all of their growing up to make decisions big and small. This also affected our clients as they now return to adulthood and they have to make their decisions. And our Halyard agents work closely with them to help them build that trust and confidence to make their decisions in adulthood. Now, please understand as we talk about these two factors that we realize that our clients owe so much to the families and the professionals that cheered them on every baby step along the way. And it's this support of these professionals and family members that built their skills and confidence that got them back to us. But as they rejoin the mainstream, it's our job to help them find balance with praise and decisions. Okay, so emotionally, what can I say here? With daily cognitive, physical, and social challenges, it only makes sense that our How Your Clients struggle with accuracy to identify and manage emotions and motivations, those for themselves and for others. And as I look at this, and every time I watch our clients go through their daily lives, I am just awestruck with how hard they fight every day to get through that day and on to the next. So this is our clients, but let's stop and take a look at the real world they live in. Now, for all of us, the boundaries and expectations of adulthood can be complicated. However, for our clients, the real world expectations can be downright confounding. Let's get a sense of that by looking at a few things that we use every day for measure and exchange. Here we have four concrete things we use. We use them at work, we use them in stores, we use them in our own kitchens. And they sort of look relatively simple and concrete at first sight, and quite frankly, they are. These are the measures we use for all organization and exchange. However, for our clients, if we cut them in half and take a closer look, we'll get a sense of truly how complicated they are. And of course, we have the pound, which is based on 16, cut in half is 8. We have the dollar, which is based on 100, cut in half is 50 cents. We have the hour, of course, based on 60 and half, it's 30. And the day, based on 24 and half, it's 12. Now, these things can be rather confounding for my clients and intimidating. The imperial measure of pounds and ounces and pints and quarts and their teaspoons and tablespoons and measuring cups, that kitchen drawer and those recipes can be really confounding and intimidating for my clients. Pay stubs, money, we said, looking at money, money is the most friendly of all. It's based on 100, in half it's 50. This is all pretty relatable math. However, money has to work with these other systems, right? When they're making purchases at the deli, or they're making purchases based on pounds, ounces, or unit prices and getting a sense of value, they have to understand what is happening there between money and these other systems. One of the biggest areas of frustration for our clients is where money intersects with time. On their pay stubs, they'll get an hourly sort of tally that they worked 3.5 hours. Now, that doesn't mean 3 hours and 50 minutes. For most of my clients, they might think so. That means 3 hours and 30 minutes. 3.25 hours is actually 3 hours and 50 minutes, not 3 hours and 25 minutes. Very frustrating and complicating for our clients. Now, they come to us from this academic world, and they may well know how to count money in a sort of set environment, but there's a huge difference between counting money and managing money. We all understand that. There's a huge difference between telling time and following a school schedule to then planning time and managing time. And we all can understand there's a difference between the academic skills and the real life management of these things. And these things, for our clients, these are the tangible items. These are the concrete, measurable things. You know, we're not even talking about the complexities of relationships where if I like her more than she likes me, then she has the power in the relationship and I'm sort of chasing that, right? So not just is it complicated to be our clients, they live in a complicated world. Let's face it, we all do, right? So how do we try and manage the responsibilities and the relationships? Well, let's talk exactly about that. That's sort of how we break it down. We talk about for our clients, helping to manage their responsibilities and their relationships. Now, let's first talk about relationships. The simple fact of the matter is 90% of our time here at Halyard for the agents is devoted to maintaining health and balance in their relationships. But when they first come to us, the most urgent need is to manage their responsibilities, to help them understand a bus schedule or manage a checkbook, you know? So what we try to do is we try to create tasks, systems, and routines to carry them like an extra skeleton through these responsibilities so they can feel at home in their home and in their independence. Now, these structures and tasks and routines are really there to help them manage their time, their money, and their transportation. And let's take a quick look at what a good system is. And we're going to use a system we all know and understand. I hope we all know and understand. Anyway, we were all taught this in grade school, right? This is addition. 88 plus 33 equals 111. Now, I'm going to let you in on this. 88 plus 33 does not equal 111. And some of you knew that right away by looking at it. Others of you found it out when I said so. And if you're in that second group, don't worry. That's where I would be too. However, if I asked any one of you to check my work, if I sort of said, hey, I'm on the phone here and you're in Tucson, Arizona, and I call you up and I say, hey, just doing some math and I don't mean to show off or anything, but I got 33 plus 88 equals 111. And you say, well, give me a second, let me check you on that. You would check me on that and you would tell me, well, actually, John, I did check your math and it turns out that you're wrong. That 88 plus 33 doesn't equal 111, it equals 121. And because we have that system in common, because we were all taught the same way to attack this problem, or any problem like it, not only can you tell me that I got it wrong, you can tell me why I got it wrong. You would say, John, slow it down here. You know you want to add the ones column, right? And then when you get your total, you're going to have to carry that one and then add your tens column, right? And so because we all had a set way to attack this problem and a mutual understanding of that attack plan, you all can not only help me to realize it's wrong, you can show me where I went wrong and help me make that correction. And we try and create routines for our clients to carry them through their daily tasks and functions in the most logical and respectful way possible in order to effectively maintain their independence in their adulthood. Now, in our next webcast, we're going to spend the entire webcast talking about the exact systems and routines we create for our clients in the most pragmatic and creative way to maintain their adulthood and their integrity. But let's spend a moment talking about the relationships. Relationships, like I said, is 90% of what we do. The first 6 weeks, 6 months, year and a half, we work hard to create and maintain the daily structures of their responsibilities. And all that while, we're building a trusting relationship that we're going to use to manage the relationships for the remainder of their time with us, because relationships becomes their adulthood. Let's talk about a few things we try and do here with relationships. And this is only scratching the surface. But here at Halyard, we work hard to help our clients understand the boundaries, expectations, and communication. And to do this, we literally try and teach and illustrate these concepts. I have a picture here off my shoulder, and this is a picture I've drawn more than a few times, trying to illustrate the relationship and the balance for our clients, and often when they find themselves in an unhealthy balance. The example I can use for this, because it happens every once in a while here, and we learned it as we went, was that after a year or so of being here and learning how to do bus travel and taxi travel, we kind of came to realize that some of our clients sort of figured out, if I get out of the taxi first, I don't have to pay for it. And this was sort of, we sort of tip our hat. Hey, good job figuring all that stuff out. However, when they started to use that, it started to impact their relationships. Let me give you an example. So Bob here on the bottom and Jim here on the top would go to the movies together. And Jim would say to the cab driver, hey, make sure you drop me off first, then Bob's going to be right down the road, you can drop him off. Now, Jim would get out of the cab and not pay for it. Bob would get out of the cab and have to pay for the whole cab ride himself. And this didn't happen once, this happened two or three times. And we started to see, by working with the responsibilities for Bob, that he was spending more money on a Friday night on taxi cabs than he really should be. And so, here's how we approached that problem. First, we sort of identified it, and then we went to Bob. We went to the victim, not the perpetrator. We went to the victim to sort of help them to hold this boundary, because this boundary, we're not going to be there at 9 o'clock on a Friday night when they're coming home from bowling or the movies. So we have to help Bob understand what's happening and help him hold his boundary here. So we say, Bob, I'm not sure if you're aware of it. I'm not sure if Jim's aware of it. But you're paying for all the taxi rides on Friday night on the way home. So the best thing you can do, because you can't afford to do this forever, is tell Jim, listen, you pay the cab ride there and I'll pay the cab ride back. We give him a way to solve that problem. Most importantly, create a boundary and hold that boundary. So we do that for Bob. And then we go to Jim and we say, Jim, I don't know if this is by accident or if you're getting carried away here, but you're sticking Bob with a taxi bill every Friday night on the way home. And it's only so long before Bob has had enough with that and he's not making plans with you anymore. So we say to Jim, you know, you might want to look at that and change that because eventually it's going to cost you that friendship. And this sort of leads to our next piece that we do a whole lot of, is natural consequences. Now think about how we did this. For Bob, who's paying for the taxi cab, his natural consequences are financial, right? It's money. The consequences are you literally can't afford this relationship every Friday night. For Jim, who's perpetrating this scheme, his natural consequences are social. If Bob's aware of it, he knows now he's being played, Jim. You can't afford to do this or you're going to lose the friendship. And so we try to explain the expectations and boundaries and communicate them. And then we also try hard to illustrate the natural consequences of adulthood. If you're sort of scheming and ditching your friends on the bill, eventually that's going to be a social impact. If you don't stand up for yourself, that's going to be a financial impact. And we try and work those relationships from all sides. Now, we'll talk in great detail about the relationship management. The simple fact of the matter is, folks, is that they live and we live in the same complex social world where dynamics and details really matter. And we have a full-time job helping them to understand the forces within them and all around them. And we're going to come back and do webcasts specifically on relationship coaching and management for our clients. But what's really important is the relationship here. We want to end this webcast by talking briefly about the relationship of our support community. Let's look at the members that make up the Halyard community. Of course, it revolves around the clients with the support of their families, and it's all tied together with the agents of Halyard. As we had just mentioned, we work hard with our clients to help them maintain healthy balance in their relationships. We emphasize in relationships respect overall, because respect is the core of any and all healthy relationships. We define for our clients respect as healthy boundaries, expectations, and communication. These same principles apply to the health and harmony of our Halyard community. And we must clearly understand our roles and our relationships, because these roles and relationships, they are the key to Halyard's success. Now, it's near impossible to define the family's role, but for our purposes, we've boiled it down to three critical areas: financial support, medical support, and emotional support. Financially, we depend on our families to manage the funding agencies and maintain financial stability behind our client, as is outlined in the Halyard financial policy. Medically, we expect our families to make all medical decisions in emergencies, as well as making decisions regarding medical testing or medical treatment. And emotionally, we expect our families to provide a stable support system behind our clients and maintain communication directly with their Halyard family member and with the Halyard agents. The Halyard agents. As we mentioned earlier, the Halyard agents create systems and structures to help support the functions of our Halyard clients' daily lives, as well as to provide coaching and advice through the ups and downs of their many relationships, emphasizing, of course, boundaries, expectations, and communication. And with their family's support and their agent's advice, our clients enjoy the proper balance of support and freedom. Now, it's important for us to understand that we can create opportunities and we can create experiences for our clients. However, ultimately our clients are responsible for their actions, their decisions, and their independence. They will create their adulthood based on their skills, their motivations, and their comforts. And as a community, we all must understand that adulthood is not a destination, but it is an ongoing journey. And our clients will be called to weather their share of storms and sun-filled days. And the health and balance of our community is their greatest asset. With our support and understanding, the Halyard clients will be as social, as employed, and as active as they can manage. At times, they will direct, and at times they will defy the elements around them. Because a ship is safe in the harbor, but that's not what ships are built for. Until next time, we thank you for the opportunity to work so closely with your family.